The goal of routing is to determine the shortest path between nodes. Like many things in life, there is often more than one solution to a problem. Distance vector was one, link state is another, which is the focus of this video. The basic idea behind link state is rather simple. There are two phases involved. Phase one is called reliable flooding, where to begin with, each node knows the cost only to its immediate neighbors. But finally, each node knows the entire graph or the network topology. Once you have the entire graph, root calculations are rather straightforward. So this is part of phase two. Each node can then use well-known and efficient algorithms like the Dijkstra's algorithm on the graph to calculate the optimal path to all the nodes. Phase two is rather simple. The challenge is often in phase one. So this is what we will focus on mostly. So tell me, how can one go from this state to this state? So this name should give you a hint. Let me give you another hint. Have you ever told a juicy tidbit to your friend and next thing you know, everyone in the class knows about it? And similarly, if someone else has a juicy gossip, in no time you get to know. So what's happening there? Use that to go from this initial state to this final state. Each node, if it somehow conveys its neighborhood information to all the nodes, this neighborhood information is henceforth called link state. So A will tell others that it is connected to B and to C at a cost of 1 each. So this is the neighborhood information that A will tell all the nodes in the topology. And if every node does this, finally A will know the entire topology information. One point I wish to emphasize here is that this information has to be conveyed reliably. This is very important. Why? Suppose this was the original topology connecting A, B, C and this link has failed. Now A detects that this link has failed. So as far as A is concerned, the topology it thinks is this. So this link is not there. Now let's say it tried conveying this information to B, but somehow that packet got lost. You are not reliably conveying this. Now what does B think? B thinks that this is the entire topology. So to reach C, B will send packets here, whereas to reach C, A is going to send packets here. So the packets will now get stuck in a loop, which you don't want. So let's get back to the problem of how does a node convey this link state information to all the nodes in the topology. If we address that, each node can then have the entire topology information. So what are your thoughts? Suppose I were to tell you the IP addresses of all the nodes in the given topology, then can you establish connections with all these IP addresses and thereby convey whatever information you want to convey? Well, that was a trick question. In order for you to route the packets to the correct node, how are you going to send them? I mean, there is no forwarding table. In fact, that is what you're trying to figure out as part of this routing process. In reality also, a given node often does not know what are all the other nodes as part of the topology. So how to solve this problem? The flooding is what is employed. Simple idea, you tell your neighbors the information you want to send and ask them to pass it on to their neighbors, so on and so forth. Finally, everyone will get to know. So here it is. A has some information to send, so it sends it to its neighbors B and C. C, on receiving this information, since it received on this interface, it doesn't make sense for it to send it back to that particular neighbor. It forwards it to its other neighbor, which is B. Similarly, B, when it receives this packet, it is going to forward it to C. Now, if your logic is dumb, what C can do is once it receives a packet from B, it may think, okay, this has come here, so let me forward it in this direction. And similarly, when B received a packet from C, since it came on this link, it can forward it on the other link. And now the process is kind of going to repeat and these packets are stuck in a loop. So flooding has to be done with a lot more care. If you thought flooding was rather straightforward, the next few slides will dispel this notion. Often when you implement, things turn out to be a lot more complicated than the basic idea. So we are going to focus on how to implement flooding reliably, what features should this flooding approach have, and in this process, you will see certain problems and how to address those particular problems. As I mentioned earlier, reliability is very important when you convey this information. So when A sends a packet to C, it has to ensure that this packet has reached C reliably. And we have already seen enough reliable protocols. So there are mechanisms to achieve reliability. So I won't get into more details there. We already saw the looping problem before. We need to avoid that. But more importantly, we need to minimize the number of messages exchanged to achieve flooding. Ideally, if this were the topology, on each link, you just want one message to go. This may not always be feasible, but that is what we will like to achieve. So how would you avoid this looping problem? Think of a solution. Apart from the looping problem, there is really no reason for B to send a packet to C after it hears from C as well as A. Even this you want to avoid. This will minimize the number of messages exchanged. So how can all this be handled? Rather simple, you need a mechanism to detect duplicates for which if packets have unique IDs, based on this, you can detect whether a packet is a duplicate of what you have already seen. If it's a duplicate, you can thereby act accordingly. A simple way to act is to maintain state. Let me call it send flags. So let me give an example. Suppose when B heard from a packet with an ID, let me call it X for now, it knows that this information has to be sent to its neighbors C and D. So it's going to kind of put a tick. But even before it acted on it, let's say it also heard from C, the same packet with ID X, in which case it knows it doesn't have to send it on C. So it will change the tick to cross. And after this, it just needs to send it out to D. So this doesn't happen then, only this happens. We are not done yet. This is in fact the simpler problem to handle. There are more complex issues. In a practical setting, topology changes, in which case this new information should precede the old information. Again, let me give an example. In this topology, let's say the cost of 3 has changed from 3 to 6. But prior to this, A has sent out information that A to B cost is 3. To both nodes B and C. By the way, it would have also sent A to cost C is 1, but for now we will ignore that. So C received this information, B also received it. Right after this, let's say the cost changed to 6. So A is now sending new information saying that A to B cost is 6. So that information has now reached B and it has also reached C. But prior to this C acting on it, let's say C had already sent this information to B. So B has received this first. After this, it has received this A to B is equal to 3. So should it act on this or should it act on this? How does it know which one is the newer information? How would you solve this problem? Again, the solution is not difficult. One can use sequence numbers, and these sequence numbers also uniquely identify the packet. So this is with reference to the previous problems where I mentioned you need a unique ID for a packet to detect duplicates. So the sequence number can act as that as well. And what happens is that each node, when it sends a new information, it is going to increment the sequence number. That way, in this particular case, this message is going to have, let's say, sequence number of X plus 1, whereas this will have X. So B knows to act on this and discard this particular message. If you introduce sequence numbers, what can potentially go wrong? We have seen this before. Well, what about if the sequence number wraps around? So how would you handle this? Again, a simple solution, use a very large sequence number space, 32 bits. Unlike in earlier cases where wraparound can still happen when you use such a large sequence number, it is much less of a problem here because these link state information messages are sent not so often. Let's say if they are sent once every second and you're using this much sequence number space, how much time will it take for your sequence number space to wrap around? Basically 2 to the power of 32 seconds, and if you do the calculation, this turns out to be roughly of the order of 136 years. This router will likely die before hitting wraparound. We are still not done. More issues. What if you have sent a packet with sequence number 4, but it got corrupted and this had become, let's say, 128. What problems can it cause? Quite a few problems. Let's look at it from the perspective of a node A. So the node A received the sequence number. So it stored the information, some link state information specific to this particular sequence number. But this is a corrupted sequence number. Now the source, the original generator of this link state information, now has sent another message with sequence number 5. And now when this comes to this node A, what will it do with this new sequence number 5? Will it accept it or will it discard it? It gets discarded, right? Because this has a bigger sequence number than this. So this packet gets discarded. Not only that, any other sequence number that is being sent will get discarded till you hit this 128. Big problem. How do you handle it? Well, you should use checksums to the extent possible so that you can detect such corruptions. But checksums are not foolproof. So the way to handle that is each entry that is stored at a node is aged. For example, this entry will have a lifetime. Let's say you set it equal to 10 seconds. After this time, it is going to be cleared out. So it may happen that during this time, you may reject all these sequence numbers that are coming, but once this entry is removed from, you will act on the sequence numbers that are coming later. So finally, you will get to the right state. Not done still. What if a router crashed and came back up? What sequence number should it use? Now you know why network researchers are in business. Lot of subtle issues. When a router crashed and came up, it will have absolutely no idea on what sequence number it stopped it. So for all practical purposes, you might as well start with any sequence number. In which case you might as well start with sequence number 0, and that is what it does. Naturally, if it starts with a sequence number 0, the older information that it sent may still be in the network topology, in which case nodes may not act on this newer sequence number 0. So for this, it is very important that this older information not stay in the network for long, because it will interfere with newer information. So for this, a technique which we have already seen before is to associate each packet with the time to live, and once this time to live reaches 0, you're going to remove this particular packet. So specific to this router that crashed, and if it had stayed down for a really long time, hopefully all this older information would have cleared out, in which case sequence number 0 will work fine. But if this router crashed and came back up immediately, then this older information, there's a good chance that it is going to stay in the particular network, in which case it will get discarded after some time, based on which this particular sequence number will come into action. One optimization this node can potentially do is, if this node were to hear its own packet, this corresponding to this older information, it can look at the sequence number and it can increment the sequence number within this packet and reuse it. So in other words, it starts out with 0, but if it were to hear some old information of itself, it is going to look at the sequence number and it will increment that sequence number and start using this. Now we are done.